So my name is Joshua Ingram. I'm going to go ahead and jump right into the presentation. And I'm a student at New College of Florida. My advisor is Dr. Bernard Klingenberg. And my research that I'm presenting today, which is on the generative process of solar flares and their non-Poisson behavior, actually originated from work from my undergraduate statistics and applied mathematics thesis. I did it a year early so that I could focus on more research related to what I'm presenting today in my fourth year. So let's jump right into it. So first, I'm going to make you all some experts on the sun. So you're going to be solar physicists after this, I hope. So first off, what is the sun? I'm sure you've seen it before. If you look up, it is that bright ball of plasma and gas and just radiating in the sky. It's what gives us life here on Earth. And in this image or this time lapse you're seeing is actually the sun, but at different wavelengths. So each color corresponds to a different wavelength. And you can see the structure of the sun actually changes depending on the wavelength, because depending on the heat or the temperature, you can actually see different layers of the sun, and each layer has different temperature. And the layer we're most interested in is called the solar corona, which is the high temperature portion of the sun's outer atmosphere. It is bright white aurora looking thing on the edges of the black disk. And this extends hundreds of thousands of kilometers into interplanetary space. And that's what we're going to be focusing on, things that occur there. But first, we need to talk about the solar cycle. So what exactly is it? Well, it's this on average 11-year cycle of increasing and decreasing solar activity. There are two main phases that we're interested in. One is called the solar minimum. And you can see what the sun looks like near the solar minimum in this image near 1996 and 2006. It doesn't look like there's a lot going on. And then there's the solar maximum, which you can see what that looks like around 2001, 2002. And there's all these bright spots. The sun looks very active. There's a lot going on. And we characterize the solar cycle by sunspot counts and active region counts. And active regions were those bright areas you could see in those images. And these are areas on the sun with strong magnetic fields. They occur in pairs. So you can see in this image here, this was taken with a magnetogram. So this visualizes magnetic field energy or the magnetic field. And you can see these black and white spots on the sun, and those correspond to active regions. And that's how we are able to identify them. And there are a lot of solar phenomena that occur here. And what we're interested in are solar flares. And that's what my research focuses on. So solar flares are these bright bursts of light and radiation. You can see in the video on the right-hand side, a solar flare going off that is much larger than the size of Earth. It is huge. It's like hundreds, if not thousands, of nuclear bombs going off. That's the amount of energy that's being put out by these things. And they're caused by an impulsive release of magnetic energy from the sun. So the magnetic field lines in these active regions are like twisting, and then they snap and they release all this energy and they come back together as a result of magnetic reconnection. The physics behind this are very complicated. So there's a lot of work to be done. And that is why I'm studying these solar flares. So why should we bother studying solar flares? Well, one, they can affect Earth's atmosphere. That's actually what causes like the aurora you can see if you go up north. They can also damage electronics and satellites, and they're dangerous to astronauts in future space missions, such as the Artemis program, trying to set up a lunar base, or things like the James Webb Space Telescope. They can damage them, they can cause issues, they have also affect radio waves, so they can affect communications. So there is a lot of reasons that we should study these things. And by understanding flares, both physically and with statistical models, we're able to predict them eventually. And we can predict space weather like we do with weather here on Earth. We can also determine the frequency of super flares like the Carrington event. That occurred in the 1880s, I believe. And even back then, with not as much technology as we have now, it still affected communications, and it could be seen even in Earth's atmosphere. And then also, it's important to understand flaring events here on our sun, because we can extrapolate these results to other stars, because flares also go off there as well. So as far as what I'm going to talk to you about today, here's just an overview. First, we're going to go over solar flare observations. We're going to model the flares as a Poisson process, identify and evaluate some goodness of fit tests, and then determine if flares follow a Poisson process. So let's get into the solar flare observations. I'm going to go over this pretty quickly, but we use these things called the GO satellites. They're managed by the NOAA and NASA, and we have data from 1996 all the way to late 2019. And where these satellites are always looking at the sun. You can see in the graph I have just which satellite at any given time are making observations. And when we detect flares, what we do is we look at the flux. So at any given time, I believe it's every 5 minutes or every 2 minutes, we are taking measurements of the flux on the sun. And if we see a spike that is significantly above the background noise and the flux, that's what we'll characterize as a solar flare. And depending on the height or the intensity of the spike, so the peak flux, that is how we will characterize the flare by its, or that's how we'll classify a flare. And there are several classes. There's A, B, C, M, and X. A class flares are the least intense flares, and X class flares are the most intense. And you can see, let's see. Oh, I don't have the image here. But we're going to get into modeling flares as a Poisson process first. And flares, so typically what's done by astronomers is they assume that flares follow Poisson process. And these are useful. It's useful because, I mean, the Poisson process has many nice properties. And there's also a lot of models, physical model, like theoretical physical models that assume a Poisson process. And if something, in our case, flares follow Poisson process, their counts, so say the number of flares per month, will follow Poisson distribution. And their waiting times, so the difference between the start time of one flare and the start time of the next flare, will be distributed as exponential. And if we have a Poisson process, we have to make several assumptions. One is that the events are independent of each other. So if one flare goes off now, it won't affect the next flare going off. And then at any given time, the rate of occurrence is constant. And that rate is what we call lambda. So before we start fitting a Poisson distribution to counts or exponential distributions to the waiting times, we need to know how we're going to evaluate how well things fit. And I use two methods. One are probability plots, and the other are some formal statistical tests. But just to briefly review what probability plots are, you just graph the theoretical cumulative probability versus the empirical cumulative probability. And if your points line up well to a 45 degree line, that's going to be an indicator of a good fit. And if they dip below or above, that's an indicator of a bad fit. And if they dip below, you're going to want to note this, is that indicates that they are overdispersed. The observed distribution is overdispersed relative to what you'd expect, like if we're fitting an exponential distribution. And that just means there's more variability in our values than we would like. The other tests we use are goodness of fit tests, like the Anderson-Darling test and the KS statistic. And these look at the CDFs. I actually did a power analysis and determined that what I call the corrected Anderson-Darling test is the best. It has the most power at sample sizes of about 40 to 50. This is similar to the Lilly-Forst test. It's simulation-based, but I will not get into that here. So as far as looking at flares and looking at their counts and fitting to our data, what we do first is look at the distribution of flare counts by year. So we have these two solar cycles, and we break them up into, I think, 19 or 20 or so different data sets, so for each year. And then within those years, we break up 365 calendar days into 37 bins of length 10. And then we take the number of counts that occur within each 10-day period. And that's how we create our distribution of 10-day counts for each year. And then we fit a Poisson distribution to those 10-day count data. And we use maximum likelihood estimation to get our rate parameter, which is just the mean of your sample. And looking at the yearly 10-day counts fits, we see that there's a lot of variation within each year for the counts. There's a lot of zero counts, especially near the solar minimum. You can see that around 2004 to 2009, there are a lot of zero counts. And then for the other years, you can see a lot of variation within years and a lot of variation between years. So looking at the probability plots, we see that we have a lot of poor fits. And in all years, according to the corrected Anderson-Darling test, this was a bad fit. The Poisson distribution was constituted a poor fit. And then looking at the flare occurrences within active regions, because clearly there's this issue of flares going off, they're affected by the solar cycle. So what if we just look at flares coming within the same active regions, because they follow the same distribution, they occur at the same rate within the same active region, supposedly. Well, we look at the waiting times, which is just the difference between the start time of one flare and the start time of another flare. And we, when we do that, we fit an exponential distribution to the waiting time distributions. And we find that for 50% of active regions, the exponential distribution was a poor fit, according to the Anderson-Darling, corrected Anderson-Darling test, for active regions with at least 30 flares, and also roughly 50% for active regions with at least 50 flares, because we wanted to have sufficient power with our statistical tests. And, you know, this is odd, right? If it follows a Poisson distribution or a Poisson process, we'd expect it to be close to 100% of active regions that this would be the case, but we have a mixed relationship. And this overdispersion is caused by two main reasons. One, in the yearly data, it's because there's this overlapping. So flares from different active regions have their own rate parameters, and or they occur at their own rates. So they're not identically distributed between active regions. And then also within different active regions, they may come from the same a different active region, but each with their own rate parameter, and they're overlapping. So constantly the yearly rate is changing within the year. And then also within the active regions, this is likely caused by the fact that flares are not independent of each other. So they're occurring close in time and spatially, and one flare going off in an active region could affect the next flare going off. Simulation supports some of this, some of these explanations as well. So just to close up, moving forward, my work is to continue the investigation of a non-Poissonness of flare occurrences, find an alternative to a Poisson process to model flare occurrences, and then conduct a more thorough power analysis of these goodness of fit tests. And then use these results to update power law models, which is on a whole nother portion of this research. So just to summarize, I have this here. And thank you so much for listening. And please let me know if you have any questions.